presence. Come on, do you feel it? Hallelujah. Let's sing it.
The presence of the Lord is here.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Feel it in the atmosphere.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Good morning, Acts family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We're so grateful you joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and follow us on social media at Acts Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to actsantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. And you can also give by mail and send it into P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. Now this week's verse is 1 Timothy 4:14, which says, "Do not neglect the spiritual gift that has been given to you through the prophecy spoken over you." Friends, even if we don't know exactly where God wants us to be, we're still gifted. And you have all these passions and desires inside of you, which is good. But ask God to make it clear. That way you know exactly how you're blessing yourself, believers, and other non-believers. And remember, here at Acts, we're here for you, we love you, and we want to pray for you. So send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
It's another beautiful Sunday that we're coming to you to praise and worship the God that we serve, who sits on high. We praise God today. Join with us. You're all I need.
You're all. I am happy to be back with you. This is the last in our series on spiritual gifts, or at least in this series. I may preach on this subject again in the future, but the point that I want to make here today is that Jesus decides how we are to live in community. Why? Because he wants a community that honors him, first of all, and that honors each other. So we're all caught up in these political ideas of what is best for my community. But that's not what God's intention is. His intention is that you, the church, you, the believer, you, the Christian, serve one another in the area of your giftedness. That's what he's concerned about. He's not concerned about these political positions that we're taking in America today or around the world for that matter. So the ideal world for the Lord is one where we are, as he says in the scripture, giving what we have to one another, serving one another to honor him. And I dare say if we take time to develop that, to work on that angle, to look like that in the way in which we operate with each other, God's going to be very pleased with us. Not so pleased with the way we handle things now, but much more pleased with us. So how do we build this community out? Well, today's topic is gifted to serve. Gifted to serve. And we've talked about this. I'm going to go back to a passage of scripture that we used earlier on. 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 10. One verse today, and here's what it says. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. That's a simple passage of scripture, and it captures for us this thought that God has given us this divine enablement, this ability to do some very special things, and he wants us to use those gifts to serve one another. That's what Peter says. So many people are using their spiritual gifts without even knowing it. I believe that people are doing the things that God wants them to do, and they don't even realize that they're operating within an area of giftedness. And look, that gift, because they're using it, continues to be effective. It's going to continue in its effectiveness in the area of that specialty that they have, even though it's not being encouraged by the leadership of their church. Because some leaders don't even know what spiritual gifts are and how they should be used. We have abused this term, spiritual gifts, in the church. Or we do exactly what we've been told not to do. We focus on one gift instead of the many gifts that he's given to the church. I think that this passage speaks to three keys. One, each believer is gifted. You are gifted. I am gifted. Some of us are blessed to have more than one gift. Not everybody, but some are. Number two, each believer is to bless another believer with their gifts. They weren't given to us to use for us or for our benefit. They were given to us to use for the benefit of the whole. And the third thing is that all believers are to act responsibly in our giftedness. We're not to overwhelm people with it. We're not to dominate people with it. We are to use it for equipping saints for works of service. That's what God has called us to. Now, Dr. Mark Baker wrote this fabulous book, in my opinion, entitled something like, Jesus is the Best Therapist That Ever Lived. And I think that's true, of course. Here's what Baker says. The beginning point of both salvation and psychological health is the recognition of our need for others. I need you, and you need me. We need each other. And I think that Dr. Baker has it correct. He goes on to say that spiritually speaking, we need a relationship with God to be whole. Psychologically speaking, our mental health depends upon our ability to relate to others. So we need relationship with others as well. If we see others as adversaries, we must protect ourselves against them. We become defensive and run the risk of damaging the very thing that we are trying so hard to protect, that relationship. Jesus taught that humans are relational beings. He often spoke about the importance of our vertical relationship with Almighty God and our horizontal relationship with each other. God spoke about this. Jesus spoke about it in the scriptures over and over again. So to Jesus, spiritual health is what happens when relationships are intact, and sin is what happens when relationships are broken. Can I just repeat that statement? Because I think it is clearly the truth. And that's why I said earlier on that the Lord wants us in community with each other, not sinning against one another, but in good, healthy relationships with one another, both spiritually and physically. So here, let me repeat it. To Jesus, spiritual health is what happens when relationships are intact, and sin is what happens when relationships are broken. So to the first point, believers are gifted. Each one has received a gift. God wants everybody in His church to be ministered to by another Christian. We have been created to minister to each other. This means that Jesus is the greatest therapist who ever lived. It just points it out. This is what He wants. He wants relationship with you, and He wants you to have relationship with others, healthy relationships. Now, I've been watching some of these political debates in our country right now. This is voting time, so everything is very intense. And I watched a couple the other night, and these two individuals proclaimed to be good Christian people, but boy, were they tearing each other's character down. And I'm wondering if they've both lost sight of what God's intention is. See, God doesn't want us as Christians to destroy the rights of human beings. He wants us to love human beings. We have to figure that out. I realize that it's intense because many people say, well, I'm voting this way because the Bible says this. But it's interesting, I find, that when you look into their lives and you look into their existence and how they do life, they don't do the other things that the Bible say do. Love one another. They don't love one another. Yeah, so we have to understand this, that we are representing who the Lord really is. And He wants us to be in community, not just getting along, but serving one another. Let the greatest among you, He says, be your servant. Think about that. If these two people on stage debating each other, one says, because clear their throat, he says, oh, hold on a second, let me get you a bottle of water. He goes over, he gives him a drink of water. How would we receive that? No, we want him to choke so that nobody will understand what he's saying. Maybe even choke and die right in front of us. Yeah, we have these wrong concepts. Love prevails over everything. The scripture says that the greatest among these, love is to be. Yeah, God has called us to love each other. He anticipated that there would be emotional challenges in life and mental breakdowns and human dysfunctions and addictions and human grieving. If you watch people that are grieving, man, they're just in a horrible state of pain, emotional pain. But God wants us to come alongside those people and nurture them. God doesn't want us to operate as if we don't care about each other. So in order for the community to work like God wants it, He blesses each believer with at least one spiritual gift, so that we can use that gift clearly to serve someone else. And that's exactly what God wants. That old African proverb, it takes a village, to raise a child is very significant here. It can be related and translated to the church of the Lord. It takes every believer, every Christian in the local church to minister to each other to grow the church. You want your church to grow? Are you serving someone in your church? Are you meeting the needs of the people in community with you? That's what He's asking us. It takes every Christian to minister to each other in order for the body of Christ to grow. to grow with the right priorities, that is, to grow in with sensitivities to what God has told us to do, to grow it spiritually and to grow the church numerically. We have to be sensitive to each other. We have to serve one another. No one comes in to tell the other what to do. We come in to serve each other. And that's what the church has to be. The church has to look like we are serving one another because God wants us to do that. And I don't just mean look like on the surface. I mean in the internal workings of the church, we have to be willing to serve one another because God has put this ability in you and He wants you to engage with other believers in the area of your giftedness. In the book of Romans, Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, we all know this. You may not know where to find it, but you all know this verse. It simply says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus." Now, I raise that up because Jesus is the God that we know. He's God the Father's Son, and God wanted to give the church something. So what did God give the church? He gave His Son to die for our sins. Look at God in heaven modeling for us what the special gift is that He gives, and yet that gift must serve. And that's what Jesus did. He served His people on this earth. We too must serve God's people on this earth. We're the only representative that God has left on the face of the earth to exercise that privilege. And when we exercise that privilege, we give God glory. He gets glory out of what we do. He's calling us together to do that, to grow the church and to grow it with its right priorities in a healthy way. You know, Jesus is so concerned about us. The Word of God says, "For by grace you are saved, not of works." So doing the work that He's called us to do is not going to save us. It's His grace, His unmerited favor that has saved us, which is why He gifted us with the special divine enablements, the spiritual gifts, because we are saved. If you're not saved, you don't have a spiritual gift. You may have an unusual physical ability. You may be mentally astute and smart and intelligent. You may be on the highest scale of those with intelligence in the world known to man today, but you don't have that divine ability unless you get saved. God gave His Son so that you and I could be saved. What a gift. What a precious gift. What gift is there greater than giving your child? That is a huge gift. It's one that's not always appreciated, but it's a huge gift. So we see this in Ephesians, same story repeated. Paul writes in Ephesians, he says that in chapter 4 and verse 7, "But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ." His gift. Grace is being measured out to us. Jesus is certainly God the Father and this grace that He gives and this word that is being used here by Paul as he writes is charisma. Charisma is what gifts are. Interesting. Christ, gifts, grace. That's the word, charisma. So Christ is charis. To the church, we must say that we are the gifted individuals of Ephesians chapter 4 and 11. The men have a natural talent of leadership to some degree of maturity, and Jesus gives them for the purpose that He designs of maturing other believers. He said, that's why you've been given that gift, to mature, to grow others in the faith. So here God the Father gives His Son, Jesus, and certainly Jesus comes to the earth. And what does He do? He not only brings us into faith, but He grows us. He grows the church. The individuals need to develop their own spiritual gift. We have to discover what it is, and then we have to develop it. Now, before I leave you today, I'm going to actually give you a website that you can go to and take the online gift test. And not only will you get an answer immediately, but based on what you put in, but then they'll also email you a copy of what you have put in so that you'll have your own giftedness. All you have to do is go to our website, excuse me, acts.org. And on it, there will be a tab that you can do spiritual gifts and take that test. I'll make it available to you. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11 through 16, listen to these words. And he gave some apostles, the prophets, evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers. Verse 12, why? Why did he give those individuals to the church? To equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, exactly what I just said, so the church can grow. He says, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Verse 14, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, by the human cunning and by craftiness and by deceitful schemes. Verse 15, rather speaking the truth in love, he says, so that this whole issue, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. And verse 16, from whom the whole body joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped. So when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. You want to know where to find the love in the church? Well, ask yourself, are the saints, those with the gifts in the church, are they building up one another? Because the more we build up one another, the more love comes out. God shows his love to us. We create an atmosphere of lovingness. We create an atmosphere where others can grow spiritually. That's what the church is for. That's why God put it here, so we can permeate the world community. God didn't put the church here for the world community to permeate the church community. He put the church here so that the church could permeate the world. That's why he sent us out into all the areas of the world to make disciples, to grow the church, to help people discover their giftedness, to help them develop their giftedness, to challenge them to work in the area of their giftedness. That creates a community where we're all thinking like Jesus thinks. We're all serving like Jesus served. We're all loving like Jesus loved. That's a community that God is looking for. He's not looking for the church to become this authority over human beings. He is the supreme authority. The scripture says that his Father put all power in his hand, not our hands. He didn't give us that authority. He has that power and that authority. But he's calling us. And friends, the only way we're going to figure that out is that we get into this word. If we get into this book and look for what God has given us in very special giftedness, we will develop these gifts and they will begin to work. And as I just read to you, the body will grow by that every part supplies. You do your part, I do my part. We do those parts together and we grow. That's what God wants. That's why spiritual gifts, that's the purpose of spiritual gifts, to change the community to look like God wants it to look, not to change the church to look like the world wants it to look. We do enough of that. The distribution of spiritual gifts is under the sovereign direction of God, the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 11, and here's what it says. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually just as he wills. The gifts come from the Holy Spirit. as the Holy Spirit wills. Now, if there's a Godhead, a triune Godhead, and there is a triune Godhead, that means Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are working together. They've designed the church to be a certain something. And we are part of that design. You are valuable in the economy of the ecclesia, in the economy of God's church. You are valuable. You are an asset that God wants to use for his glory and benefit. You know, when you look at these things and you see what God has done, he's suggesting to us that, that we need to talk a little bit more about these gifts in the church. We need to talk a little bit more about helping each other develop these gifts in the church. Because the church is going to be the community. Ultimately, all of the earth is going to be wiped out. The only thing that's going to be standing is the church. I'm not talking about the building. I'm talking about God's people. Because when he comes back, this world is going to be destroyed. Ultimately. And we're going to be in the community with him only. That is amazing. That's why we want our relatives saved. That's why we want our children saved, our grandchildren saved. That's why we want everybody we know, our good friends, saved. We want them to come to faith in Jesus Christ. And he's given you the ability, the gift to reach out and minister to their hurts and their hopes. That's God's plan for us. That's why he's done all of this. That's why we're taking the time to read it and to study it and to see what he says. So what's my second point today? My second point is use your gift to serve one another. Whatever it is that God has given you, use it to serve someone else. And by the way, if you're not in relationship with someone, if you don't have a friend that you talk to regularly, or you don't go out of the house because of this COVID thing that's going on, you need to develop friends. God is interested in you having relationships. Because if you don't have relationships, you're not going to win anybody to the Lord. You need relationship. And God has given you that gift that you need to minister to somebody else. If you have no friends that you're in community with, if you have no one that you talk to and work closely with, who are you going to win to the Lord? How are you going to use that gift? Excuse me. I think that we have to agree with what the Apostle Paul is saying. This whole idea of this using our gifts to serve one another. Look at it at our text that I read to you earlier, 1 Peter 4:10. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. Third part, as good stewards of God's varied grace. Three parts of that text. So bless one another with your gifts. Minister it to one another. Serve, that's what the word minister means, serve one another in your giftedness. You don't have to force it on someone. But when Peter uses this term in the Greek, one another, Peter is talking about you use this gift for another of the same kind that you are. That's what he's saying. You use this gift on another Christian. That's what he's saying. That's what he's telling us. We have to serve each other. And then when we use it in this context of one another, he's saying towards yourself. Because it's to your benefit. God has given you a tool. It's to your benefit to use that tool to build the kingdom of God. That's this whole idea. It implies that all form this whole body. All of us together form the body. I'm not the church and you're not the church. Together we are the church. If I use my gift to serve you and you use your gift to serve me, we are going to form this community, this body of people that believe in Jesus Christ. But without using your giftedness, friends, it's not going to happen. Because he says that's how you mature the saints. You want saints to grow up and be strong in their faith. You want saints to be able to encourage other people, to get into relationships with other people and help them. Well, that's the purpose. That's the tool he's given you. If you're going to do that, you can't just tell your kids, you got to go to church in the morning. Pretty soon they'll rebel against that conversation and they won't go at all. Or the moment they get out from under your roof, they'll stop going. You want to nurture that soul. You want to bring that soul in lovingly into relationship with Jesus Christ. You want to use the gift that God has given you, the divine enablement that he put inside of you to serve that person. We win people by serving them. That's God's plan. That's God's plan. And when you win them by serving them, you will have them forever in the kingdom of God, eternally. They will never leave. But you're not going to win them by beating them down and tell them they got to go and they must go. No, you have to lovingly show them the purpose of it. You should tell them that God has a gift for them. And he wants them to discover what that gift is. And as you see it in them, you are to encourage them. Because that gift is what's going to grow the church. And again, I'm not talking about grow the church in numbers. I'm talking about church universal, people coming to faith in Jesus Christ. That's really what I'm talking about here. So we are to seek the good of others, meaning seek what God has put inside of them. They are there to promote good works, not for themselves, but for the kingdom of God. And then the next thing that I want to tell you is that he says, behave responsibly. And that's the key here, friends. Behave responsibly. God, he said, be good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Do what God has called you to do, but do it the way in which God has instructed you to do it. Use your gift as God has designed it to be used in the body. Don't abuse it. Don't abuse it. We have a lot of Christians today that are abusing what God has given them. A steward is responsible for another's resources. We are responsible for our brother's resources. That's why they did all things in common in the first century church. They brought everything together into one place and distributed it among themselves to lovingly help each other. They became the resource for one another. You know, there's so many ways to do things that God wants us to do, the way that God wants us to do. A Christian does not own his own gift. That gift has been given by God to manage our relationships within his kingdom. That's why that gift has been given to us. Meaning, God gets the glory for what God has done. I don't get the glory. When I go out and I preach and people tell me, boy, that was sure a good message, or God, you bless us with what you said, or that kind of thing. My only interest is that they heard what I said deep in their hearts and that God will use what was poured into them. That's the purpose of it. That's why we preach, to build people up, not to tear them down. The job is to build people up, to equip them for works of service. So they can go and do the work that God wants them to do. That's how he builds the body. He said that it's fitly joined together by that every joint supplies. So I guess we could ask ourselves, what am I supplying to the kingdom of God today? He uses this term, manifold grace of God, to emphasize the vast designs of God for these gifts. When you look at a piece of marble and you see the beautiful lines going through it. They're very distinct. Well, look at the church that way. God has put marvelous lines in the church so that we see the ultimate beauty of what God has in that stone that we're looking at. It's amazing when we see things the way God has designed them. God understands the needs of the church better than we do. So he's put the ingredients in. He's developed a resource for the church because he knows what the church needs. He knows what you need right now today. He knows what I need right now today. And because he knows these things, he's put all of these gifts in place for that purpose. Now we have to go discover them and then develop them and then use them. He knew someone would have to die for the church. So what was the gift? He sent his son to die. The ultimate sacrifice to be made. God has never left us without gifting us with what we need for each other. Never. Never. But when we depend upon our government and we depend upon our politicians and we depend upon all these other resources, we have forgotten the resources that God has put inside of the church, the gifts that He's given the church. We are the resource God has given us to be used for Him. Also come, Lord Jesus, use me up for yourself, for your glory. That's the heart of how we should feel. That's the real epitome of it all. He knew that the church would need understanding. He knew that the church would need protection. He knew that the church would need knowledge and comfort and love. That's why He gave those gifts. The manifold grace of God. Be good stewards of that grace. That's why He gave us that grace. That's why He gave us that gift, so that we would manage it, so that He gets glory from it. He gave the church gifts so we would operate with each other in love and unity. So what's our learning outcome? I dare say that I realize that you may not yet know your gift, because it's possible that Christians have been operating in their giftedness and don't even know that they're operating it because they have never identified it. They've never identified it. And just by natural means, they have developed it. You know, some people that just love no matter what happens. Some people can pray at any time. People can serve in different ways at any given time. You know who these people are. They're your friends. They're in church with you right now. And you can point them out. But you see, I think that we have to explore what He has given us. We need to dig into it. And I hope that this series that I've just completed today will challenge you to dig into what God has given you. I want you to go to our church's website. I'll have it put up on the screen again for you here. And go to the tab for spiritual gifts. Take that test. Print it out. Talk to your friends about it. You know, tell them, I don't think I do this, but have you seen this operate in me? Discuss it. And then take advantage of developing it. Take your time to figure out, how can I use this for the glory of God? How can I use this for the benefit of another person in my church? What can I do with this? How do I help people with this? To all believers, God has given divine ability to serve. And it's our responsibility to discover that giftedness and then not only discover it, but put it to use. That's our obligation. God wants His family to be functional, not dysfunctional. He doesn't want us fighting over things. He wants us willingly serving in the role that He's put us in. Dysfunction takes place when you don't know what to do. We call that ignorance at some point. Or you don't know how to do it. Then the dysfunction sets in. But if we study our giftedness in the area of our giftedness and develop it, we will know what to do and how to do it and when to use it. That eradicates the dysfunction, the ignorance. We become knowledgeable. The only other thing that gets in the way of a person using their spiritual gift is disobedience. I know I have this gift. I know God wants me to do this, but I refuse to do it. We have people like that in the church too. But God wants you to use it. God wants His family to be functional. As we unfold the areas of giftedness and you discover your gift and are willing to develop that gift and commit yourself to serve in God's church. When you serve in your giftedness and I serve in my giftedness, we add to the body of Christ. We make our Heavenly Father look good. And excuse me, there's nothing better. Your parents will tell you. You cannot make them feel any better than when you give them glory. When you use what they have given you for glory. God wants you busy for Him. You are a resource to His heavenly community on earth. So would you employ that giftedness? Would you dig a little farther? And just work with it. Pray and ask the Lord to enlighten you illuminate passages of Scripture to your heart so that you might do the things that He wants you to do with that giftedness. And we have others that don't know the Lord yet. Friends, I want to invite you to come to Jesus Christ today. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. Friends, getting saved is the beginning of that Christian walk. Because at the moment you accept Jesus Christ, His Holy Spirit gifts you. And when He gifts you, He seals you into the body of Christ for all eternity. Now it's up to you to find out what that gift is that He put in you at the moment you were saved, and then develop it so that you can use it to give God glory. God bless you, friends. God bless you.
Alone in a room, it's just me and you. I feel so lost, 'cause I don't know what to do. Now what if I choose the wrong thing to do? I'm so afraid, afraid of disappointing you. So I need to talk to you and ask you for your guidance, especially today when my mind is so cloudy. Guide me until I'm sure. I open up my heart. My hopes and dreams are fading fast. I'm all burned out, and I don't think my strength's gonna last. So I'm crying out to you. Oh Lord, I know that you're the only one who is able to pull me through. So I know I need to talk to you and ask you for your guidance, especially today when my I open up my heart, oh Lord. So show me how to do things your way. Don't let me make the same mistake over and over again. Your will be done, and I'll be the one to make sure that it's carried out. And in me, I don't want any doubt. That's why I want to talk to you, Lord. Yes, I do. And ask you for your guidance, especially today when my mind and world seem so cloudy, Lord. You can guide me through. That's why I open up my heart. All I need to do is just hear a single word from you. Ooh, I open up my heart to you, Lord. Guide me until I'm sure. Oh,
You're the captain of my sea. I need a word from you. Oh, Lord, I open up my heart, my heart. Oh, guide me until I'm sure. I open up my heart. Oh,